Okay. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
And, of course, happy Mother's Day. Today we're going to, well, actually, before I even do announcements, I'm going to have you watch a video, especially for today, and then we'll have our regular video later. Okay.
Thanks. Have a good night.
We don't need
listening
lessons like that, or gymnastics.
Money
bank lessons.
Yeah.
They're just expensive, you know
what I mean? Oh, no. Hey, please.
Sorry, we closed already. Come back tomorrow.
No, but tomorrow's Mother's Day.
Hey.
I've cash.
Let's make it snappy, boys. I got some hungry kitties to get home to.
I don't know why you want to buy your wife something that's just going to be dead in 3 days.
It's a thank you for all the slack she picks up with our family. I mean, you and I both know I'm a mediocre dad, a husband at best.
Hey, listen up here, mi amigo. Buying your wife a bowl of petunias is not going to assuage your sins for being an extremely subpar father and husband.
I didn't say extremely subpar.
You didn't have to. You know, Mother's Day gifts, they just seem so desperate. I mean, take me for example. I gave my wife, Victoria, the best gift that she will ever have.
A diamond?
My offspring. What woman wouldn't want that?
Okay, here we go.
Just let that sink in, the truth will set you free. Alright, okay. All the phones. Is there like eucalyptus in here? Is that eucalyptus or is that a cat?
Oh. How much is this?
$175, I think.
Told you, $175. I'm done by Wednesday. Hey, la macaroon. Don't mind if I do. Okay, that's gonna leave a mark. Hey, hold your gifts. We got a couple of pizzas. What's up for the missus? Attention, everybody! That's not a eucalyptus. That is a bona fide cat. I'm okay.
I'll go ahead and take this before he destroys the place. Is this your shop?
No, it's my mom's place. She opened it when we were kids.
So I guess you didn't get her flowers for Mother's Day.
Actually, every Mother's Day, she would let each of us kids go through the shop and pick out something to give her. We don't pick out the biggest, most expensive things we could find.
So I guess she bought her own gifts?
Oh, she paid for her flowers and much more. She paid with long days and short nights, replacing her worries with prayer. She gave up what she needed so that we could have what we wanted. She gave up more than I'll ever really know. But she didn't look at it that way. She would say, "You all are my true little flowers, and it's my job to make sure that you are watered with love and placed in the light of the sun." I mean, that's what moms do, right? They help us grow in God's love so that we can be a witness to God in the world. So, I thank God for her daily, and nowadays I spend cash in the register and I pay for her flowers on Mother's Day. Receipt!
Can you put these in the tab, please?
Door.
Okay, I'm holding it with my foot. I am towing the door.
I got it. Happy Mother's Day. Oh, boy.
Today we honor not just the moms, we certainly honor them, but we also want to honor all the women and girls in our congregation and have you stand up and we'll say thank you for who you are. No, really. Diane, they're not believing me. Thank you guys for all you do and all you are. And make sure. Oh, okay, there you go. You can sit if you like, but Daniel and Kate are handing out little gifts for, and these guys, Brianna and Xander too, thank you for handing out stuff. We want to honor all of you. A couple of other announcements while they're going around. These guys, and I know you probably recognize them from other videos we've had, they're actually have just put out a full-length movie that I expect will be about as much fun as the other videos that they do. It's called, and I think I just put it, what's it called? Camp, Family Camp. It'll be starting this Thursday, May 12th through 18th. It'll be in Downingtown and other places. They have matinees and evening shows, and probably a good thing, not only a fun thing to go to, but maybe to invite somebody else to. And yeah, you can look up the times, obviously. So, also, on May 22nd, guess who will be here? No one. Right answer. Right answer. Because we're going to be next door, Church in the Park. All the churches are going to join in. Thank you, Pete. Excuse me, I'll be done in a few minutes. thanks. hopefully that you will be able to be there for that. I don't think you're going to be able to park real close by. If you're in the choir, you can get a car pass. So I didn't mention that when I was inviting you, but there's one more rehearsal if you want to join now and come this Saturday at 10 o'clock to the Methodist Church. But otherwise, there you can park at Impact Church. It used to be Church of the Open Bible. You can park at the Mennonite Church. You can park at Dewey Pile and get a van, a trolley thing, whatever they call it, a bus that will take you over to the park. But the other two locations, that's the only, Dewey Pile is the only place there's going to be a little minibus. Okay, are there any other announcements that I need to make? Alrighty then. Now, let's take a moment and sing if you'd like, or just listen and worship in your heart to Michael W. Smith. And pray. Lord, forever you are faithful, you are strong, and you are with us. And we're so grateful, Lord, for all of those things and for all that you have done and continue to do in our lives day by day. Today we come to praise you, to give thanks, to grow deeper in the knowledge of you. And I pray that this time would be a blessing and an encouragement, and just that we would enjoy being in your presence together. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, now you get to do some singing. If you would stand as we sing Immortal, Invisible, and then another one. So we want to continue to lift Debbie and her family up. We also, it's good to see Joe here. Yeah. Yay! Do you want to update us, or do you want me to just read what Diane wrote?
Read what Diane wrote.
Okay, and then you can tell us whatever you want. Joe needs our prayers. For the doctors to find medicine that will work, and for comfort for his back.
Baby steps.
Yeah. And and patience too. That's tough when you're going through stuff.
For Tony.
Angel, but also Tony. Okay. Macy had an unexpected trip back to the hospital this past week. It's her ear again. She's been maybe March, they were trying to get the surgery for tubes in her ears, and she's just had these issues with the blood counts. just not being able to be taken care of. So on top of all the things that she's been fighting with her cancer, she has earaches and they can't do anything about them, put tubes in. But now her liver and her pancreas are areas of concern. All the staff are going to be meeting to discuss a new treatment. Then she'll be admitted for 5 or more days. Her body is rejecting the chemo now. We need to lift her up for the doctors to find a cure for her family. And she has been such an incredible fighter over this year plus that they've been dealing with that as a little 8-year-old girl and her family. I know Lynn Vanderhoof said that she's going to make a map. There's so many people that she knows who are praying for her all over the country. And she's going to try to make a map and put markers in all the different places that people are praying. So if you're if you've been praying for her, then let Lynn know. I mean, we're all here. They know there's a lot of people here. But if you have passed it on, some folks she had mentioned, she passed it on to a prayer group in another state. And but continue to pray for them. Talk about needing courage and encouragement. Also, we continue to pray for Doris. She keeps going through, working through treatments and procedures and medicines to help her find comfort and strength with her back and legs. Tamara, for quick healing and patience as she recovers. Tamara, as you may remember, broke her left arm and her right hand. So that kind of limits you, and I know, I think I mentioned last week that doctors told her basically don't do anything. You can do your therapy and nothing else, and that's just not Tamara's style. So be brave for Tamara and Oz. So are there any other prayer requests that we want to mention at this point? Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we do give thanks to you for all of your goodness and faithfulness. Lord, we give thanks on this Mother's Day for our moms and ask a special blessing on them, and especially moms who are still in the process of raising children. I'm not sure that process ever ends, but we pray for them. And Lord, we pray for those for whom this is a difficult day. We've had several folks who have lost their moms, not in the fairly recent past, and even those of us who have lost them quite a while ago, our minds turn to them on this day. And Lord, I pray that as they do, that they would be able to especially remember what is good and what they have experienced that's good in their family member, as well as to be comforted in the midst of this, whether it's a mom or a child who's been lost, or just folks who struggle with that relationship. Oh God, I pray that you would bless and encourage and just help us to remember that we have always have you who loves us all the time. And we're thankful for that. Lord, we lift up the folks that we've mentioned who just need healing and strength. Father, we lift up Doris and Tamara. We lift up Joe and Macy. Lord, for all of them, we pray that doctors would be able to find effective treatments and that you would relieve them from the suffering, the pain that they are going through. Lord, we especially lift up Macy as she just has this even more concerning news. Lord, we continue to pray for a miracle for her. I know it's been a miracle that she's still with us, but Lord, how we would love to see this little one healed. But Lord, we just entrust her and her family into your hands and ask that you would be present with them in a powerful way. Lord, we pray for our church, and we pray that we would be seeking as individuals and as a church to grow in you and to just bless others in the same, just as you have blessed us. Lord, that people would know your presence because they have seen the grace and kindness that we have shown to them. We pray, O Lord, for the war in Ukraine, and we ask that you would bring it to a halt. Lord, that too is asking for a miracle, I think, at this point. But Lord, we just pray. We just pray and give it to you. We pray for our country and the divisions that we face, and we ask for healing. And Lord, help us to be part of the solution in all of that. These things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Well, with all the hard things we've gone through over the last 2.5 years, there have been some positive things that have happened. One of them is there has been a boom in home gardening, which seems to be still going strong, not just in our own country, but around the world. They say that in the first several months of the pandemic, the increase in gardening just totally mirrored the increase in cases. Early on, it was a coping mechanism for a lot of people. For many, it was a way to relax, to socialize safely, to connect with nature, or just stay active. One person said it created a buffer to all the depressing news. And we need that, don't we? One first-time gardener said this: "I never previously had the time to commit to a garden, but I found such satisfaction and happiness in watching things grow. It has been a catalyst for making other positive changes in my life. I am not a gardener. I can kill almost any plant you give me. I haven't ever tried it, but I suspect I can kill plastic plants. But, which is probably why I find it amazing that you, not me, that people can bury something that looks like just a little rock in their backyard and have vegetables, you know? That's amazing to me. Maybe, like I say, especially because I can't pull it off myself, I don't think. So in this morning's passage, James mentions what God has planted in us and some of the inner gardening needed for that seed to grow. As always, James is straightforward, maybe even blunt, about pulling out the weeds, the things that get in the way of growing in Christ. Let's take a look at James chapter 1, verses 19 through 27. "My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires." You know, try writing those verses on a sticky note on your fridge or your bathroom mirror, you know. If we all were able to apply that one verse, think of how everything would change, right? Or two verses, I guess. Verse 21, "Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that's so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they've heard but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world." I've always been struck with those first verses: be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. To say that that's the opposite of what we hear from our culture would be an understatement. We're constantly hearing, get angry, make noise, never listen, and never give any respect to anyone who disagrees with you. Listening is a lost art. When was the last time you stopped, looked somebody in the eye, and listened to what they were saying without interruption? When was the last time somebody stopped and looked you in the eye and listened to you without interrupting? If it's recently, you're blessed. Make sure you thank the person who does that for you. Try to pay attention to your listening skills. I know I can do the same thing. I get busy and I, you know, just, yeah, and off I go, and then I go, wait, what just happened there? I wasn't with them. I wasn't hearing them. In his wonderful book, The Road Less Traveled, Scott Peck says, listening is the work of love. If you're wondering how you can demonstrate love to someone, try listening without interrupting, without judging, and without thinking about what you're going to say in response. And definitely without messing with your phone. Try listening for the sole purpose of understanding, especially if they think something different from you. Be quick to listen and slow to speak. Freely offer the love-filled gift of listening. And be slow to anger. Can you imagine how our society would change if people decided to be slow to anger? Not even if they stopped getting angry, just if they decided to be slow instead of going, what? Right? There are, you know, people being angry and making others angry is big business in our country, right? A lot of people make millions of dollars to get you to be angry all the time. They're good at it too. Even the calmest, most reasonable people in the world, if you listen to these folks long enough, you'll be angry. Because it just seeps into us. It's so easy to take the bait. And I've been guilty of it too. Sometimes the off button is the best thing. for some of those things. So wouldn't it be great if Christians decided to lay down our outrage and decide we will be slow to anger and quick to listen. Because as James says in verse 20, human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Can you think of a time that losing your temper made you more like Jesus? Anyone? Anyone? Me neither. Me neither. Now, anger in itself is not a sin. But it can easily lead us to sin, to treat people in ways that are hurtful and damaging to relationships, and in ways that dishonor God. Being quick to anger produces an unrighteous life, an ungodly life, an unhappy life, an ugly life. And again, it's not never be angry, but be slow to anger. And that way, you can make some reasonable decisions about whether this is something that is reasonable to be angry about. Maybe you should take some action as opposed to just bam, right? And I have to think that that's what James means in the next verse, in verse 21, when he says, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent. We may assume when we hear a phrase like moral filth, we kind of go to some kind of sexual sin, but that's totally out of the context of what James is talking about. I think he's talking about what happens in our lives when we fail to be slow to anger. He talks about the evil that is so prevalent. In other words, it's just surrounding us in our society. In Romans, Paul says in one translation, don't let the world squeeze you into its mold. And I think that's what James is saying also. And the world is always trying to squeeze you into its mold. Instead, we are to humbly accept the word planted in us, which can save us. James is writing to people who already believed Christ. This is not an evangelistic word in that sense. His message of salvation was already planted in them. They've already accepted it. The word accept can also mean to take hold of or to grasp. And so I think of that word being planted, but like let it germinate, right? Let it grow and be nurtured. I think he's urging his readers in the midst of a world cram-packed with evil to hang on tight to the truth of the gospel, the truth of the scriptures, and even more to Jesus Christ himself, the Word made flesh. Allow that to grow. Allow love and listening and kindness to grow. Don't let the weed of anger choke out the seed planted in you. I wanted to read these verses from the Message version, which I did put up there. Post this at all the intersections, dear friends. Lead with your ears, follow up with your tongue, and let anger straggle along in the rear. God's righteousness doesn't grow from human anger, so throw all spoiled virtue and cancerous evil in the garbage. In simple humility, let our gardener, God, landscape you with the Word, making a salvation garden of your life. Right? So that you are then life-giving to others. I love how he expands on that garden imagery of the Word planted in us. I said I'm still kind of amazed that little seeds can produce produce. Something that looks lifeless grows into something nourishing and life-giving. And that's exactly what God wants to do in us, to allow those things to grow and not only bring life to us, but that we'd be life-giving, that we would produce fruit that would bless others. Hang on to what God has planted in you. Nurture it consistently with scripture and prayer and worship and faithfulness and service. And then he goes on to say, don't just listen or read the Word. The best way to hang on to that Word of God is to do what it says. Imagine visiting a surgeon for the first time and you ask him about his credentials. You see a diploma from a great medical school. It even says he graduated with the highest honors. His office is lined with medical books. You see lots of recent journals with markers, you know, sticking out of the pages and all dog-eared and carefully read. So you ask him how familiar he is with this procedure, and he says, there is probably no one who has read and studied and watched more videos about this than I have. And then you go, but how many times have you actually performed this surgery? And he smiles and goes, you're going to be my first. And I'm so excited. You're already gone. I heard you snickering out there about the videos. You're out of there. Reasonably enough. Reading stuff is great. I am all in favor of reading and learning. But there's no substitute for doing. And the same is true with our growth in Christ. James uses another analogy. He talks about a mirror. If you want to present yourself well in the world, you need a mirror, right? Because if you can't see how funky your hair looks in the morning, or that piece of spinach on your tooth, you won't do anything about it. But having a mirror doesn't help if you don't do anything about what you see. And he compares that to hearing the Word, but not making any changes based on what we see there. Instead, he says, look intently into the perfect law. And that word literally means stoop to look. If you stoop to look at something, you're taking time to see, right, what's going on. Wait, let me get down so I can really, I can't do that, but so you can really see what's going on. And it means if you are continually looking with that care. If you read the Bible every day, I can guarantee you one thing. Sometimes it's going to be boring. I know, that's not what she thought I'd say, is it? I bet you've never heard another pastor say that, have you? But it's true. But keep reading. Keep looking intently. Keep praying for insight, and very often you will get it. It's the consistency of that that brings value, that staying in it, that remaining in it. Don't give up because, well, yesterday it didn't do it for me. That's all right. That doesn't matter. Just keep going. So another day it will. That's you know, but it's like a seed. You don't see it growing every single day. But that doesn't mean it isn't, right? Keep nurturing. And then do something with what you've read. Do something with it. It may be as simple as meditating on the meaning of the verse. It may mean you have something to confess or someone to apologize to. Or maybe it's doing something to serve others. If your car is out of alignment, the tires will wear unevenly, and you may have steering problems, right? The car can pull you one way or the other. When our lives are out of alignment with God's word, we may also have some steering problems as the world keeps trying to pull us in the wrong direction. Eugene Peterson talks about, he's a pastor and author, and actually he's the one that wrote, that translated the Message that I read from earlier. But he talks about at one point in his life, he took up long distance running. And he started getting a bunch of magazines and started reading through them carefully. And then he pulled his muscle and he couldn't run for a couple of months. And he realized that he stopped reading the magazines until he was better and he started to run again and he started to read the magazines again. So when he wasn't going to do anything with what they said, he had no interest in them. But if he's going to take it and use it, if he's going to go out on the turf and run, then he's like, well, let me learn a little bit more. And I think that's how it is with growing in Christ and reading the scriptures, that if we're not seeking to live in active response to God, then the Bible will be pretty boring. But it's when you want to live what's in there, when you want to please God, that then you start going, huh, I wonder what about this situation. You know, I should read that thing. When the most important question isn't what does this mean, but what can I obey? What can I do with this passage to live it? Simple obedience will open up our lives to a text more quickly than any number of studies and dictionaries or concordances. Not that there's anything wrong with those, right? Soren Kierkegaard said, when you read God's word, you must constantly be saying to yourself, it is talking to me. It is about me. And it's about God, but it's also talking to you and your relationship with God. Oswald Chambers says, never try to explain God until you have obeyed him. The only bit of God we understand is the bit we have obeyed. And James gives us some good ways to do that. In verse 26, he says, those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Anybody else have a mouth that gets them into trouble? I know some of you do. I won't name names except my own. You know, again, be slow to speak, slow to become angry, and quick to listen. And he concludes with some other concrete ideas about obeying the word, nurturing what God has planted in us. Verse 27, religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. Larry Burkett, some of you might be familiar with, he had a used to have a Christian radio program about finances, but I found he had a lot of godly wisdom about a lot of things. But he believed that in our society, when we read about widows and orphans, that we should think about single moms and their kids, because they are some of the most vulnerable people in our society. And that's what they were talking about in the scriptures. The widows and the orphans were the most vulnerable people in the society. So it's like, look out for those people who are on the edges, who are struggling. Looking out for the most vulnerable is an overwhelming theme of scripture. And that comes in a lot of ways. The poor, those who have some type of disability, the ones society tends to ignore. There are so many invisible people. Those are the ones we're told to have particular love for. This week I have a couple of challenges. Pay attention to what a good or not so good listener you are. Try not to interrupt people. Try to listen. And look at the people you don't normally pay any attention to. The list may be different for different ones of us. Maybe it's a store clerk. Maybe it's the wait staff. Maybe it's children. Maybe it's older people. If you catch their eye, don't look away, give them a smile. It's not everything, but it's a start. We look at people as if they're all people. And I think that's one of the things that is really broken down, or maybe it never was, in our society, is that we started to look at other people as if they're not people. So whether it's somebody on the other side of the political aisle, or somebody that you just never noticed before, or somebody in need of help, recognize them and pray for them. And if you can do something for them, do it. I was reminded, I was in the Methodist Church, and they had up a quote from John Wesley, who of course is the founder of the Methodist Church. And I thought we Baptists would do well to listen to it too. He said, do all the good you can, by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. Let's pray. Lord God, I pray that there would be just a change in our society, and Lord, especially, Lord, that in our own hearts we would seek to be people who are quick to listen with respect and treat others with dignity, that we're slow to speak, that we're slow to become angry. Lord, make us a blessing to others, and teach us to not just read the word, although certainly to read it, but to do it, oh God. Let our ears be open to hear from you, for when you nudge us and say, how about that one over there? They could use a little help. Lord, we have been blessed. Let us be blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. And our final chorus, if you would stand and sing, I Offer My Life. Praise to our Father in heaven. Go in peace. God bless you. And happy Mother's Day.